Let's take out our Bibles and learn together.
A word of prayer, and then we'll start our seminar. Father God, we exalt your holy name. We bless you, we praise you, we give you thanks that you are our God, that you have saved us through your grace, that you have a purpose for our life, and that we will spend eternity with your kingdom because of what your Son did for us upon that cross. We thank you for the blood of Messiah that reconciles us to you for eternity. We thank you for that power that changes and transforms our lives, that we might be a praise unto you. We ask now that you would bless this time of study, that you would open our eyes to your truth, that we would have a desire to implement all things according to your scripture into our life, that we might be found faithful. For the days, they are changing. We are moving rapidly to the last days. And Father God, we want to be prepared. We want to be faithful. We want to be obedient servants in whom you are well pleased. All this we pray in the blessed name of our Lord and our Savior, Messiah Yeshua. Amen. The Bible reveals that there is a spirit, and I'm speaking of the spirit of the Antichrist. And when we look at the last days, our Lord and Savior, our Messiah, gave us instructions. He tells disciples. Now, he told his original disciples, those 12, but it has special application for us who may be living in the last days. When the disciples came to him and began to ask him questions, he told them to watch. Now, I think that's very significant, that word watch. In fact, he uses three different biblical words in the Greek language in order to command us, and it is a command, to watch. Now, the first word is the Greek word blepo, which means to observe, to be paying attention, to be watching for a response, meaning you look at something, you see it, and then you're called to respond. The second word that he used is also most informing. It's the word prosecho in Greek, and it means literally to hold on to. And in the context, what he intended for us to realize is this: when we see certain things happening, hold on to what you've been taught. Don't make changes in your doctrine. Don't allow these things that believers are going to be witnessing. Don't allow them to cause you to think or behave differently. And then the third word is a word that Paul uses in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 as well as Yeshua in the Gospels. And this is a word that has a military context outside the New Testament. It means to watch. Some Bibles will translate it incorrectly with simply being awake or being alert. But it's a word which means to observe, to be looking, and specifically looking for the enemy. Watching for those who are in conflict and in disagreement with the purposes of God. It implies that there's a coming danger. Now, the question that I would ask you to think about is this: why would he say to disciples, you and me, why would he instruct us so frequently, not just he, but others, in regard to the last days, to be watching? I think the answer is simple. There are things that are going to happen that we need to see and identify them as prophetically significant. Things that we see, that we observe, that should cause us to behave in a certain manner. So we need to be people who are watching. Now, watching also is for the purpose of being prepared. In Matthew 24, a very important chapter, we see that the disciples come to Messiah as he's leaving the temple, and they speak about the buildings. And notice that it's buildings in the plural. Now, we have the word temple. I'll speak more about that in our second session. But that word temple in Greek is a very broad word. It's the Greek word heron, and it can mean several different buildings. It's speaking about the entire temple complex. And we know that on the Temple Mount, there was the temple itself, the courtyard, but there was also what you probably have heard of before, the Sanhedrin. All of this comprised the temple complex. And so when the disciple says, do you see these buildings, not just building the temple, but buildings in the plural, and how beautiful they are? We know that it took over 40 years for Herod to construct them. And Messiah said, I tell you, not one building, one stone will remain upon another that's not cast down. Now, what was he doing? He was prophesying the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. And the question that we have to ask ourselves is, was he right? Well, we know 40 years later, that prophecy was fulfilled. Now, the rest of Matthew 24 tells us about the last days. And we need to understand how these two scriptures work together. The first two verses of Matthew 24 and the rest. The purpose is simple. In the same way that he was perfectly accurate about what took place in 70 AD, he is also going to be perfectly accurate about what's going to happen in the last days. And we know that the disciples came to him at another location. Same day, but later on. And there he was at a very specific location of great significance called the Mount of Olives. Now we know prophetically and also from the New Testament, when Messiah returns, and here we're speaking about the second coming for the purpose of establishing his kingdom. When he comes the second time at the end of Daniel's 70th week, he is going to come, Zechariah tells us, back to the Mount of Olives. We know that the angels told the disciples in Acts chapter 1, the same way that you saw him ascend up into the clouds, you'll see him return. And he'll come to this place, the Mount of Olives. So from a Jewish standpoint, the Mount of Olives is always understood of having great political or prophetic significance. And so he's there sitting there, and the disciples come and they ask him three questions. The first question, what is the sign of your coming? When will these things happen? And what is the end of the age? Now, I want to focus in on that word end for a moment, because that word end appears three other times in that section, that first section of Matthew 24. When the disciples say, what is the end of the age? They use a word telos, but they put a prefix on it, the word sin, meaning with. So they're asking, what will come about? What are the things that will come about when you return? So it's a different word, but when Yeshua speaks of that word in verse 6, verse 13, and verse 14, when he uses that word in, he changes it. It's not identical, the same root, but a different form of it. Now, we don't all have to agree, but we all have to deal with the Word of God. Any truth that we're going to know about the last days doesn't originate with you and me. It originates with Scripture. And therefore, we need to pay attention to what the Scripture says. And it's significant that when we deal with the concept of end, as in the end times, the last days, we have to ask ourselves, what end was Yeshua referring to? What was he speaking about when he says, you'll see these things happening, but the end is not yet? When he says, if you persevere until the end, you will be saved. Here again, many people have wrong theology with that statement. If you persevere to the end, you will be saved. It is wrong to assume that he's talking about that perseverance, my perseverance, plays a role in my salvation. That's not what he's saying here. He's giving a phrase of encouragement. He's telling us, if we make it to the end, there's salvation. Salvation is a very, very significant word. Tsazo in Greek. It can refer to those who are healed, those who have financial success. There's a very diverse meaning of this word salvation, but it all has something in common. Salvation speaks of victory, deliverance. And all he's saying here when he says, if you persevere to the end, you'll be saved. He's saying, if you persevere, he's encouraging to tell us at the end, there's going to be what? Victory. God is going to bring about at the end victory. And what do you think he's referring to? The establishment of the kingdom of God. The end will not take place without the kingdom becoming a reality. And then he says, in the last time he speaks of the end, in verse 14 of Matthew 24, he says, it is necessary, a very important phrase. It is necessary for this gospel of the kingdom. Now he spoke about the end in verse 13. And in verse 14, he emphasizes the kingdom, that kingdom victory. He says it's necessary that this gospel of the kingdom be preached to all nations as a testimony unto them, and then the end will come. Now, my question for you, and we all have to answer this, what end was he referring to? And the answer is, knowing that he was speaking to the disciples, he was referring to the end of the church age. And that's going to happen with a blessed event, the rapture. And we'll talk more about that in a moment. Now, the purpose of this first session is to give us an overview, to give us some of the key prophetic events that's going to happen, so that as we're looking, we know what to be looking forward to, what to expect. So that we're not, as Paul says, that we're not shaken from the right perspective. And I would call your attention to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Now, there Paul is giving insight and instructions. And one of the things that often happens, I can remember not too long ago, I was speaking to a group of leaders. And we were talking again about the last days. And I asked the question. Messiah, when he comes, he's coming how? And people all said the same thing. As a thief in the night. No, he's not. Not for believers. If you look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 4, he says something. Speaking to believers, he says, you are not in darkness. That day should overtake you as a thief in the night. So for non-believers, he is coming as a thief in the night. But for us who love him, who have acknowledged him as our Lord and our Savior, our Redeemer, our God, he's not coming as a thief in the night. We're not in darkness. We're not sleeping, but we are watching. And how is he coming? Well, another very important scripture, and I apologize that we're going a lot of different places because we just want to have an overview in this first session. But a scripture that I would call to your attention is Luke chapter 12 and verse 37. Also a last day context. And he's speaking about those who are watching, those who are serving. And it says when Messiah comes, and he's speaking about for his faithful, for you and me. He's coming in a very specific manner. For those who are watching, those who are waiting, those who are prepared, those who are faithful. He's coming, and you know what it says? As a servant. The scripture says, look carefully at verse 37, Luke chapter 12, verse 37. It says that he will gird himself. Now, what was another time that Yeshua girded himself? On the eve of Passover, when he washed the feet of the disciples, when he ministered to them, signifying what he was going to do in laying down his life. So for believers, if you look at that, it says he will gird himself and minister to them. Isn't that what that scripture says? So if we're faithful, he's coming to minister to us. Amazing. And the question that we have to ask ourselves, you have to answer, but ask yourself, why in that way? Why is he coming to minister to, we'll call it this way, the church when he returns? To minister unto us. For those who he's going to find faithful. I think the answer is obvious, that we're going to need to be ministered to, because it is going to be very difficult for believers, very difficult for the church in the last days. And we need to be prepared for that. Paul says, and I'm going to go back now to 1 Thessalonians 5. Paul says something of great significance. Verse 1, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 1, he says, speaking to brothers, meaning brothers and sisters, fellow believers, he says, you have no need for me to write to you concerning the times and the seasons. Now, why would he say that? Well, he says in that previous chapter, chapter 4, he says, you have no need for me to write to you about brotherly love. The context is that loving your neighbor as yourself. Why didn't Paul need to write anything about brotherly love? Because the Torah tells it all. Why doesn't he need to write about the times and the seasons? Because the prophets reveal it all. He was speaking to people that he believed understood the significance of prophecy and made their life's decisions based upon prophetic truth. That was the assumption. But he says something very interesting about times and seasons. Now, why two words? If you look at most Christian commentators, they will just simply say, oh, that's an idiom for the last days. Not entirely. When Paul says times and seasons, there's a reason. Because he understands prophetically that the last days come in two distinct epochs of time. And we see that best illustrated in the scripture in a very important chapter. In fact, I would say probably the most important chapter prophetically for our days. And that is Daniel chapter 8. Now, one of the things that's sad about Daniel chapter 8 is that if you go to most commentators, whether they are rabbinical or Christian, they agree, but they're wrong. They will tell you that Daniel chapter 8 is a prophecy that has been fulfilled. They look at it in the time of Antiochus Epiphanes, shortly after Alexander the Great, and how his empire was divided. They look at a verse of scripture which they see, in my opinion, incorrectly. Now, the reason why I argue with the view that this scripture has already been fulfilled is because when you look at Daniel chapter 8, you will find that three times Daniel tells us concerning the vision that it's for the end times. That it's for the time when God's wrath will finally be poured out. That it's for the end of the appointed days. Three times he tells us that this vision in Daniel chapter 8 is for the end times. And what is this vision of? Just very briefly, in Daniel chapter 8, there's a vision of, and we'll talk more about this word in our third session today, and that is the word beast. Now, the word beast prophetically is an empire, a political empire, a government. And it says in Daniel chapter 8 that there's going to be a beast. Daniel calls it a ram. And we know specifically where that ram is coming from. The ram is coming from a place known as Paras Umidai. Paras is Persia. Midai is a greater area. It speaks about a geographical location that Iran, that ancient Persian, ruled over. And today, what will we call it? Iran. And prophetically, we should expect that there's going to be an empire that rises up, including modern-day Iran, but others with it, that is going to bring about, well, if you read Daniel chapter 8, this beast rises up and it does what it desires. This is an expression biblically for not being submissive to God, being ruled over by satanic influence. And if you look there in Daniel chapter 8, this ram brings about great, and hear this, great instability. We'll come back to that concept in a moment. And also a sense of hopelessness. Now, the empire is out of the east, but it moves westward to the north and to the south. And everywhere that it goes, it brings about a sense of hopelessness. What the scripture says is this: who is able to stand against this ram? There's hopelessness. It is a barbaric empire. I would suggest to you, based upon the times that we're living in, if indeed we're drawing near to the end times, that it must be Islamic in nature. Now, learn something. The religion of the Antichrist is not Islamic. It's very popular today for people to believe that the Antichrist will be related to Islam. He will not be. He won't be. You will find that the Antichrist, and again, we'll mention this later on, the Antichrist is going to do seemingly marvelous things for Israel. It's going to be the Antichrist that wants the temple to be rebuilt. It's going to be the Antichrist that brings about peace and security for a while. Remember what Paul says? When they say peace and safety, that also includes prosperity. The Antichrist is going to bring a time of peace. Well, we all like peace. Security, that's wonderful. Prosperity, that's good. But it's going to be unrighteous. It's going to be immoral. It's going to be spiritually in conflict with the truth of the Word of God. So he's going to bring it about. And then what does scripture say? When they say peace and safety, what happens? Then sudden destruction. What is he referring to here? But there's going to be an empire out of the east with its capital in Iran. There'll be a coalition of nations that come together that moves westward to the north, to the south, bringing about hopelessness. And then as you read later on in Daniel chapter 8, we have this concept of suddenly. That means without expectation, without a human ability to see what is about to take place. And there's going to be another empire that rises up. And this empire is called the goat. And if you look carefully at it, we have another term, just like we had Paras Umidai, Persians and the Medes, we have the term Yavan. Now, the term Yavan in modern Hebrew is Greece. But in biblical Hebrew, it's not speaking about Greece as an independent country as we think of today. Yavan was simply referring to Europe. So we know something, that next empire, and what's going to happen? The whole world is going to be brought into instability. There's going to be great suffering and death, a sense of hopelessness because of the activity of this first empire known as the ram. And then suddenly, without any type of human expectation, another empire is going to rise up out of Europe and defeat the first one. Now you can imagine, all the world is going to be rejoicing, saying how wonderful this empire is. It brought about peace, stability, security, prosperity. This is all wonderful. But what's the problem? That's where the Antichrist is coming from. He's going to come, as the scripture says, as a man of peace. He is going to do wonderful things seemingly for humanity, but it's all based upon deception. It's all to accomplish his ungodly purposes. Now, what are we talking about? We're talking about the spirit of the Antichrist. And whenever we talk about the Antichrist or the father of the Antichrist, in a spiritual sense, Satan. He is a man, the father of what? Lies. Deceit. When we look at our next session, what Paul says about the last days, it shouldn't surprise us. Messiah taught this same thing. There's going to be a spirit of deceitfulness. And all of that spirit of the Antichrist, well, it is a spirit, and we'll see this again in our second session, where the Antichrist is called not just a man of sin, he's called that, but also the man of lawlessness. So important that you remember that term, the man of lawlessness. Now in the Greek, the word for law, in Hebrew, the word Torah, it's in Greek, nomos. And lawlessness is really the word nomos, law, Torah, with just one letter as a prefix, the letter alpha, which is a negation. So the word oftentimes means against. So even though we always translate it, and I think in every Bible, the man of lawlessness, he's the one who is against the law. He's against the Torah. Why? Let me ask you a question. How do you think a Orthodox rabbi would answer this question? What is the spirit of the law? Think for a moment. How would you answer that? What is the spirit of the law? And I'm speaking about the law of Moses. Orthodox rabbis would answer two ways. They would say, first thing, righteousness. Why? Because the commandments tell us about righteousness. Now, the law is not an instrument that makes me righteous. In fact, when I take the Torah and I apply it to my life as a non-believer, what does the Torah tell me? I'm unrighteous. I'm a sinner. But it defines what is righteous and what is unrighteous. So the law is related to righteousness. The Antichrist hates righteousness. Why? Well, if you do a good study of the word righteousness in the poetic writings, now, Hebrew poetry is identified by what's called parallelism. Things are parallel to one another. The word that is most commonly parallel or likened to righteousness is the Hebrew word kavod, which is glory. What does that mean? When someone lives righteously, that righteousness manifests the glory of God. Satan, the Antichrist, they hate anything that brings glory to God. Why? They want all that glory. They want all that worship, right? It says that Satan in Isaiah 14, he wants to establish his throne over the throne of God. Why? He wants to be worshiped. We'll talk more about that later. But it's all of this glory that he wants for himself. So he hates righteousness. Now, the second thing about the spirit of the law is the law teaches us not only what's righteous and what's unrighteous, but the law teaches us how to love. Do you realize that? The law teaches us how to love. You say, where's that in the Bible? Very simply. Remember when Yeshua, when he was asked, what is the greatest commandment? And what he's saying here is, tell us the character of the law. And he says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And then he says, the second commandment, meaning the second one in importance, not in order, but importance, is like the first. We all know what that is. Love your neighbor as yourself. What do both of these have in common? Love. Love God. If you truly love God, that love is going to manifest itself with love for your neighbor. So the spirit of the Torah, the law of God, is love. When I take the commandments, being led by the spirit of God, I fulfill, Paul says it in Romans 8, verse 4. I fulfill the righteousness of the law. See the connection between the law and righteousness? When you walk not in the flesh, but in the spirit, you fulfill the righteousness of the law. And the law teaches us how to love one another and how we manifest our love for God. The Antichrist, he hates God. He doesn't love God. He doesn't love anyone but himself. And he basks in unrighteousness. He likes that which is unrighteous. So there's a spirit of the Antichrist. And that spirit, going back all the way to 1 John, that spirit is already in the world working. But the Antichrist has not yet been revealed. We'll talk more about that later on. So when we look at the scripture, we're called to watch. We need to know prophetically what we're called to watch of. And we see that the Antichrist, he's going to rise up out of Europe. This term Yavan, meaning Europe in the ancient Hebrew. He is going to rise up out of Europe. He is going to defeat that first beast, the ram, out of Iran, out of the east. And he is going to bring about a time of peace, prosperity, security, and all the world is going to love it. But who's not going to love this? We're not. Why? We're going to recognize it as ungodly, as immoral, as against the scripture. So we're going to be speaking out against his principles, his ways. And what is that going to bring about? Persecution. Now, I'll share with you something that I frequently hear, and I'm sure you've heard it as well. And that's this. People will always say to me, I'm not waiting for the Antichrist. I'm waiting for the true Christ. I like that. We are called to be waiting for Messiah. But is it right that we are not going to be around for anything having to do with the Antichrist? Is that the proper view? Well, let me lay the foundation for part of the second session. And that is that there is an event, very important, known as Shikutz HaMishomem in Hebrew, the abomination of desolation. Very important. We'll see why it's so important when we look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 after our first break. But Messiah, he talked about the abomination of desolation. Paul talked about the abomination of desolation. But you know where we find it most referred to us? By Daniel. And in Daniel chapter 9 and verse 27, he speaks about at the middle of the week. A week is that last 7 years. In the middle of the week, there's going to be an event known as the abomination of desolation. That's all we see in Daniel 9. There's an event, the abomination of desolation. What is it? We don't know. It's tied to the Antichrist. But other than that, Daniel doesn't tell us in Daniel chapter 9. But when we go to Daniel chapter 12 and verse 11, we're given more information. In Daniel chapter 12 and verse 11, it says about this abomination of desolation, that it will bring an end to the sacrifice and the offering. That's all we're told. This event having to do with the Antichrist will bring an end to the sacrifices and the offerings that will be taking place in Jerusalem at a rebuilt temple. That we know. Daniel chapter 12 and verse 11. But where the information is so informing to us is in the previous chapter. Daniel chapter 11 and verse 36. Now, for the sake of time, I'm not going through these verse by verse, but you should never rely, no matter who's speaking, never rely upon what you're hearing. Gets you into big trouble. Always check it out. Daniel 11 verse 36 says this, that there's one who's going to oppose and exalts himself above all that is called of God or that is holy. And it's going to be a king, right? It says in verse 36, Daniel 11, verse 36, that a king is going to do as he wants, according to his will. And he is going to do something, exalt himself, magnify himself above all that is of God, all that is of God, all that is worship. That's all we know. It's not until we get to where we're going later on. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, that Paul tells us specifically, based upon Daniel 11:36, what the abomination of desolation is. We'll come to that later on, but let me say this. In Matthew 24, verse 15, and the context is so important. Now, let's just briefly get a framework for Matthew 24. We see the first two verses take place, as we said earlier, when Messiah comes out of the temple. He prophesies the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. He's accurate. And then in verse 3, the Mount of Olives. There he speaks about the last days. Remember the questions. What is the end of the age? What is the sign of your coming? And when will these things take place? And he tells us about birth pains. Very important. Birth pains as a sign. A sign that brings about instability. Why? Well, he says there's going to be wars. There's going to be rumors of wars. There's going to be ethnic conflict. Now, your Bible might say nation will rise against nation. But that word nation is the word ethnos in Greek. It speaks about ethnic conflict. It's beginning all over the world, especially in Africa. Tribal conflict based upon ethnic differences. We'll see more and more of that. He says there's going to be earthquakes, there's going to be famines, and there's going to be, Luke points it out, in the Textus Receptus in Matthew 24, it also has it, but in other Greek manuscripts, it leaves it out. That is the word pestilence. Now, Luke says it, it's there. So, pestilence. Let me just tell you, not going to deal with this today, but COVID is not a pestilence. See, people ask, we receive literally hundreds of emails. Do you think COVID is sent by God? Is it a pestilence of the old days? Let me tell you, when God sends or allows a pestilence to happen, no one's going to be asking, is this a pestilence from God? Everyone's going to know very quickly. This is God's judgment, or this is something that God's using in regard to something that has epic significance. Now, is the enemy using COVID? I believe they are. There's many changes that are coming about from that, but this is not a birth pain event. The birth pains are going to be much more significant, and much more intense. So there's wars. There are nations rising against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There's going to be earthquakes, famines, pestilence. And what does Messiah say? He says, these are not the end. The end's not yet. Who's he speaking to? Believers. And these birth pains, along as what we see in Daniel chapter 8 with the ram, is all for one purpose, and that is to bring about instability. And why is instability so important to the Antichrist? Well, I can remember going to college many years ago. I took an introductory political science course. And I remember what the instructor said. He said that instability, and he was speaking about political, economic, and social. He says when you have instability in a country, you know what you should expect? Change. Instability is a catalyst for change. And no one knows this better than the Antichrist and his father, spiritually, Satan. He wants instability because they want a governmental change. They want an empire that rules over the world. And the Antichrist, as we'll see in our third session, the Antichrist is going to eventually take power over this empire. He is going to benefit politically from all the instability, that all of these birth pains are bringing about. Now, when these things happen, what does Messiah say to disciples? See, here's the problem I have, is that many people have doctrines and theologies about the last days, and they don't deal with much of what the scripture says. Because in the scripture, Luke tells us in Luke 21, when these things begin, when you see them taking place, who's he speaking to? Believers. So he says, when you see these things beginning, what should we be? Encouraged. Amazing. All this instability, hardship, wars, famine, earthquakes, disease, he says to us, be encouraged. Now, how does he say it? He says, lift up your heads. Now, we all know the scripture where it says that our God is a lifter of the head. We know that. What does that mean? Well, that term, lifter of the head, if you know the Torah well, when someone would give a gift, they would lift the head. What does that mean? They were counted. In Orthodox Jewish law today, we don't go one, two, three, four. You never count people. It seems as disrespectful. Instead of counting people, you want to know how many you have. They give something. They do something. They raise their hand, something to give a sign. And then they are acknowledged. How are they acknowledged? By raising your head. So when the scripture says, when you see these things, many will say, be encouraged. I have no problem with that translation. But what it literally says is lift up your heads. Why? God is going to acknowledge us. When these difficult things happen, don't be discouraged. Realize God is about ready to acknowledge us as his family. Acknowledge us as his covenant people. So these things, we see them and we know, yes, they're bad. Yes, they're hard. Yes, they're difficult. But in a short moment, God is going to acknowledge us in a wonderful way. So he says, your redemption draws near. And that concept of redemption, we have to understand it has two components to it. Now, in English, we really just have one word for redemption. In Hebrew, there's two. One is, I have a lapel pin, padut. Padut is related to redemption. You translate it with the word redemption, but it's not what we think as redemption. It's the payment that makes the outcome. When we think of redemption, we think of the forgiveness of sins. We think of victory, everlasting life. That's the second word, geulah in Hebrew. So there's the payment that makes the outcome possible. So in the scripture, when Messiah says your redemption draws near, he's not talking about the payment, what he did on the cross. It was already going to be done. When these things happen, he's speaking about redemption, meaning the outcome, which is the establishment of the kingdom of God. So that's why we should be encouraged. We know that the kingdom promise is soon to be fulfilled. Now, we look back, going to Daniel chapter 8. We see that this first piece brings about instability, hopelessness. No one believes that anyone can stand against it. And then suddenly, without any expectation, any reason for believing this to be the case, there's a new empire that comes out. That empire is out of Europe. And that empire, it says one thing about it, that he's going to move, and he's moving differently. He's moving in a way that's going to meet the first piece. And he's angry, and he moves, and this is what's significant. He moves without touching the earth. Now, what does that mean to you? Now, we hear that, and we think flying, right? If you travel without touching the earth, you're flying. But going back 2,500 years ago, in the time of Daniel, wasn't speaking about flying. This was a way to say and call one's attention to something that is supernatural. So when it says he moves without touching the earth, it's saying that this beast, this empire, has a supernatural aspect to it like none others. It is unique. You know, it's interesting. If you look again at Daniel, you will find that Daniel speaks about four empires. And the fourth one, what does Daniel say about it? It is unique. It is different. And it is going to be the worst one of all. And I believe that what Daniel was speaking about, that fourth one, from Daniel's standpoint, what he's looking at, he does not speak about some of the others. For example, when Daniel begins his count, he does not speak about Egypt. He didn't speak about Assyria. Why? They were already gone in his day. He's speaking about those that were from his time period. And he sees Babylon. He sees the Medes and the Persians. He sees Greece. And then he sees a fourth one. Well, we would think Rome. But we need to have that fourth one as not just Rome, but ultimately, oh, let me just go into it now. A very important scripture for you to be aware of is Revelation chapter 17. Here again, I apologize for being all over the place, but we want to get an overview of what's happening. And in Daniel chapter 7, there is a very important vision. Excuse me, Revelation chapter 7. In Revelation chapter 17, I'll get it right. Revelation chapter 17, there's a vision. A vision of a beast. A beast that has seven heads. And what does John say about this? John says in Revelation 17, he looked and he's speaking and he sees this beast with seven heads and a woman upon it. And he says, concerning these seven heads, five have fallen, right? Five of these have fallen. Well, if you ask any of the Christian commentators, they all get it right. They say the first one is Egypt. The second one is Assyria. The third one is Babylon. The fourth one is the ancient Medes and the Persians. The fifth one is Greece. Now, in John's day, isn't that true? These five have come and gone. And he says, one is. Who would that be? Rome. Here again, no dispute about this among Christian scholars, whether they be on the right or be on the left. They all agree that these five who have fallen, Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, the fourth is the Medes and the Persians together, the fifth is Greece, the sixth that's in John's day is Roman, but there's a seventh. And we're never told who the seventh is. We're never told. Now let me ask you a question. Because where we're going is going to have great implications to it. See, we're not allowed just to have an opinion and not be held accountable for the implications of those opinions. What we say, what we teach, what we believe has significance. We're responsible for that. We're supposed to be sharing truth with others. So we know who the first six are. That's a fact. It's the seventh one we don't know. Now, the question is this. If I were to ask you, I'm not doing that right now, but if I were, how many of you think that we're truly approaching the last days? And I mean the last days. I would guess many of you would raise your hand. I would raise my hand. But that has implications. Because John tells us in Revelation 17 that there's the seven-headed beasts. Six are gone. The seventh, well, we have to ask a question. Who's the seventh? Because John also tells us that the seventh is not the final one. There's new revelation. That the seventh is also what? The eighth. Now, do you see the implications? If you say we're really very close to the last days, then we're ready for what empire? The eighth. But then we have to know who the seventh is, because the seventh and the eighth are the same. Now, you can say we don't know who the seventh is, and it's going to come, and then there'll be the eighth. That's fine. But you can't have it both ways. You can't say, yes, we're really close to the end times, but the seventh hasn't come. I don't know who that is. You have to be consistent. Now, I want to share with you what I believe, You can accept it, reject it, think about it, study, and see it for yourself. But I believe that we are indeed very close to the last days. And I believe the seventh one has already come and has gone away. And we're waiting for the eighth. Now, if that's true, I need to do what? Tell you who the seventh one is, right? If I said it's already come and gone, we're waiting for the eighth, it's resurrection. To be fair, I have to tell you who the seventh one is. Now, what are we told about all of these empires? They all have something in common. That they were persecutors of the Jewish people. Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, the Medes and the Persians, the Greeks, the Romans, all major persecutors of the Jewish people. But if I asked you in history, who brought about the greatest suffering of the Jewish people ever, who is it? Nazi Germany, Hitler. More Jewish people suffered because of Nazi Germany than these other empires. Some have said, put them all together even, as far as death. So I believe the seventh one is out of Europe. It is Nazi Germany. We're also told something else. If you look at that same 17th chapter of the book of Revelation, it says concerning the seventh one, what's unique about it is that it comes for, the scripture says, a short period of time. A short period of time. Now, Egypt, hundreds of years. Assyria, nearly 100. Babylon, all these other empires, they were long in their existence. The only one that was short, looking at the major persecutor of the Jewish people, is the Nazi Empire. Lasted for less than 20 years. Very different than all the rest. So what I expect is that there to be a resurrected empire. Why? Because the eighth is from the seventh. Now, does that mean it has to be based in Berlin? No. Does that mean it's going to have the same swastika and every? No. All it's saying is look to Europe. There is going to be out of Europe. This is where the Antichrist is going to come up from. He is going to put a coalition together. He is going to be someone who does seemingly very good things for the world and for Israel. See, Islam would never do that. But the Antichrist, he knows something. His strategy initially, in order to defeat the purposes of God, that's what he wants. What is the Antichrist against? The kingdom of God. Everyone, in my opinion, everyone who hears the message of Messiah is going to be committed to the kingdom. You look at his parables. Most of his parables spoke about what? The kingdom of God. Over and over. His emphasis, what was his first message? His first message was the same as John the Baptist, which was repent. Why? For the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Everything that he did was about the kingdom. And the enemy hates the kingdom of God because he knows his establishment or his defeat comes with the establishment of the kingdom of God. He doesn't want that. We all know what it says in Revelation 20, that Satan is going to be cast into the abyss where he's going to be locked for 1,000 years, and then the kingdom's going to establish. He doesn't want that. He is totally against that. So we know something. We know that This empire is going to rise up out of Europe. It is going to be a resurrected type of Nazi empire. It is going to do similarly great things for the Jewish people. Why? Because he believes this, and he always believes a lie. That's something that's consistent about Satan. He speaks lies, and he believes lies. Why? He hates the truth. Remember that. Not willing to accept truth. Going to be very important. In our next study, what we find is this, that he's going to believe if he can get the Jewish people to follow him, God's purposes will be defeated. Why? What has to happen for the kingdom to be established? We know this, Matthew 23. Israel has got to say that remnant in the last days has got to say, Baruch Haba b'shem Adonai, blessed is the one who comes in the names of the Lord, meaning to call for Messiah. And what the Antichrist is going to do is going to do seemingly, hear that, seemingly good things to Israel in order that Israel will receive him. If they receive him, then the kingdom cannot come. God's purposes will be defeated. Now we know that's not going to happen. But that's the lie that the enemy has believed. He wants Israel to worship him. And there's an event when he's going to put it to the test. Now, we're going to wrap up our first session in just a few minutes. But I want to leave you with this. And that's a statement that I get so many questions. Do you believe the Antichrist is Jewish? And I write back, why would you think that the Antichrist is Jewish? And the answer is always the same. Well, if Israel is going to receive him, I figured he has to be Jewish. Where in the scripture does it say that Israel receives the Antichrist? I don't know any verse that says that. So Israel's going to reject the Antichrist. Now, Israel might be appreciative of some of the things that the Antichrist will do. All the world will be, except for who? Us. We're going to recognize him. We're going to know this is evil. But because much of Israel is in spiritual darkness, they're going to like that peace, that security, that stability, that temple being built, the freedom and the security. They're going to like all of this. But the Antichrist is going to fail. Because the event that is so important to him is the abomination of desolation. And remember what Messiah says, and we'll conclude with this. In Matthew 24, verse 15, after saying, first it's necessary for this kingdom of the gospel, or this gospel of the kingdom to be proclaimed to all nations as a testimony to them, then the end will come. What end is he speaking about? The end of the church age. And then you look at that next verse, verse 15, and he says, when the reader sees what Daniel the prophet spoke of, standing in the holy place, then let the reader know. What's he speaking about? What did Daniel speak of? This abomination of desolation. Who is Messiah speaking to in Matthew 24, verse 15? He's still speaking to who? The church. About what event? The abomination of desolation. Why is that so significant? Well, when we begin our next session after the break, we're going to focus in. It's not going to be like this session where we're all over the place looking at different prophecies and such. We're going to focus in on one location. And that's going to be 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, where we're going to see what Messiah, or what Paul says concerning two things. What Paul says about the abomination of desolation and the identity of the restrainer. Now, Paul mentions about the restrainer. And what we need to realize about that is what Paul says concerning this restrainer. Because there's a whole lot of false teachings about who the restrainer is. And we want to get it right according to what the scripture says, so that we are basing our beliefs upon scripture, not upon speculation. God is never honored with speculation. You are not going to grow spiritually with speculation. You need to grow based upon what? The truth.